Looking to hone your coding skills? Want to get into a top college for CS? Hope to ace coding interviews at big tech companies and rising startups? I'm Arjan Trivasava, an incoming freshman at UC Berkeley studying eecs, who made USACO Platinum in high school. And if you answered yes to any of these questions, you should be doing USACO as well. Let's talk about why and how. But before we begin, please be sure to like and subscribe for more STEM content, and hit the bell to stay up to date on the latest videos. Also, make sure you stick around until the end of the video because I'll be showing three secret tips to help you score higher and promote faster. Now, without further ado, let's dive right in. USACO, or the USA Computing Olympiad, is a computer science olympiad consisting of several divisions, bronze to platinum, that invites competition among aspiring computer scientists around the world, ultimately selecting the USA team for the IOI, the International Olympiad in Informatics. As you can see in this diagram, the Platinum Division is the penultimate stage in the selection process, consisting of only the top 3% of all international pre-college participants. Recognized as some of the best computer scientists worldwide, USACO contestants who qualify for the Platinum Division and beyond are also given a huge boost in apps for college and selective CS programs. Additionally, USACO contestants who qualify for even the Silver or Gold Divisions have an amazing head start for algorithm and data structure-based coding interviews. The best thing? Signing up for USACO is completely free, online, and open to everyone. So go ahead and visit their official website, usaco.org, after this video to sign up and familiarize yourself with the format and the rules. But now you're probably thinking, what exactly do I need to know to make the Platinum Division? This is a big question. As of the making of this video, not even the official USACO website makes it clear what you need. Well, after analyzing USACO's past problems, I've mapped out all the concepts you need for every division, and I actively maintain this map with every USACO contest. You can find a link to the latest version of the full concept map in the description below, but I'll summarize all the key points here. So let's start with bronze. The first thing you need to know is basic I/O. So this includes standard I/O, such as standard input and standard output streams. So you have to know how to read and write from those streams. And you should also know how to use file I/O, because many of the past USACO problems have used file I/O before they switched to standard I/O, so you should know how to do file I/O if you want to do those past problems. And you should also know how to optimize your I/O. So if you're using C++, this means that you should be untying cin from cout, and you should unsync with stdio. And this isn't immediately useful, but it will be important especially later. Then the next thing you have to know is the basic data types. So this will be data types related to integers, such as integers, booleans, and characters. Data types related to arrays, such as strings, arrays, and vectors. And data types related to tuples, such as pairs, the array class in C++, and user-defined structs or classes. And then we move on to basic if-else logic, and this will help us navigate the complex conditions that often come up with USACO problems. And then next we have syntax, and the importance of knowing syntax is how to produce simple and effective code. So first of all, we want to know how to reduce repetition using functions and structs, and then we want to know how to use the basic functions in the standard library, and then we want a general command of a language's basics to make sure that we're being simple and effective. So next we have complete search. So complete search, also known as brute force, means to try all the possibilities. First of all, we'll need to know how to do this iteratively. So that can include for, while, do, while, break, go to, continue, etc. And it can also mean finding the overall minimum or maximum or etc. in some sort of data structure in a linear scan. And we also have to know how to do this with basic recursion. So this can give us an effective alternative to using nested fors, which can help us in generating exponentially in many cases. And it can also be used for things like generating n factorial permutations, 2 to the n subsets, etc. And next we'll need general intuition, and this is best gained through practice. Next we'll need a general diagram-based understanding of graphs. So this doesn't seem to be strictly required in recent USACO contests, but this can be especially useful, because problems might sometimes involve graphs, especially on harder contests. So this includes the concepts of nodes and edges in word problems, modeling graphs using adjacency lists, and properties involving the degree of a node in a problem. And finally, we'll need to know how to sort arrays using the standard sort function. And this is highly recommended, and it can simplify code, but it's not strictly required. Now let's jump into Silver. So first we have big O time complexity analysis. And here, you basically want to know, in the worst case, how many operations is my program going to perform to solve this problem? And here, amortized analysis is recommended as well, such as the two-pointer search concept. And we also need a better understanding of pruning to cut the search space, such as the meet-in-the-middle technique. Then we have binary searching, and we need to know how to binary search for a value in an array that's sorted using the inbuilt functions such as lower bound, upper bound, etc. in C++. And we also need to know how to binary search for an answer over a monotonic search space. And harder examples of this also include monotonic mathematical expressions. Then we have sorting. So we need to know how to sort in ascending and descending order, such as we did in bronze using standard sort. And this is called lexicographical sorting. And we also need to know how to sort based on custom comparators if we don't want to sort using the standard technique. Then we have processing data structures such as stacks, queues, and dequeues, and built-in balanced binary search trees such as sets and maps. And we need to understand the tactical advantages that these provide over just running a standard binary search, such as updating elements. Then we have basic graph theory. So we need an understanding of how graphs are represented using adjacency lists and matrices, and the trade-offs between sparse and dense graphs. And then we have depth-first search, or DFS, of a graph. So this can include flood fill and connected components. And then we have offline processing. So being able to sort to process queries in order, as well as prefix and postfix some computations for fast queries. And then we need to know how to write basic greedy algorithms. And then there's sweepline processing. And finally, basic combinatorics and number theory. So this will include the principle of inclusion-exclusion, also known as PI, and also modular arithmetic. Next, we have the goal division. So we're going to start off with union find data structure, also known as DSU. So this is useful for cycle finding and connected components. Then we have algorithms related to processing, such as sorting queries in a specific order for offline processing, and doing range processing, such as using Fenwick trees, also known as bits, segment trees, order statistics trees, etc. And then we have coordinate compression, sliding window minimums and maximums, and we have monotonic stacks and monotonic queues. Then we jump into geometrical algorithms, such as interval processing and more sweepline processing. Then we have combinatorics, so we have more principle of inclusion-exclusion, as well as knowing algorithms related to expected value and linearity of expectation. And then for number theory, we have to know more modular arithmetic, which means more advanced concepts. And then we have intermediate graph theory. So for this, we have to know shortest path algorithms, such as breadth-first search, Dijkstra, Floyd-Warshall, and Bellman-Ford. And we have to know how to use priority queues and sets for these, as well as how to produce the shortest path tree. And then we need to know how to find the minimum spanning tree, so using algorithms such as Prim and Kruskal. And then we need to know general tree algorithms, such as the preordered traversal flattening trick, lowest common ancestors, and optionally, heavy light decomposition. And then a big topic is dynamic programming. So the two main types of dynamic programming you'll encounter are finding the number of paths or the exact path for something, or finding whether something is possible or not. So the standard problems in dynamic programming that you have to know are knapsack, coin change, subset sum, subarray sum, scheduling, etc. And you also need to know how to do dynamic programming on trees and graphs, such as topological sorting and finding the longest path in a directed acyclic graph. And you also need to know the difference between when greedy works versus when you have to use dynamic programming. And finally, the platinum division. Now, there isn't really that much to add here because the platinum division covers everything up to the gold division, as well as any concepts on the IOI syllabus, and even thought-provoking concepts outside of it. But here are some specific concepts that we should emphasize. So first, you should know segment trees. So there are many different kinds of segment trees that you have to know about here, but the main ones are the basic segment trees, such as point update range query, and there are lazy segment trees, persistent and dynamic. And then you should know advanced dynamic programming, convex hull, interactive problems which require you to do online processing, computational geometry algorithms, matrix exponentiation, and strongly connected components. So that wraps up all the concepts you need to know for each division. In the future, I also hope to put out videos teaching these concepts with sample problems, so be sure to subscribe and stay tuned. Now let's get into the three secret tips I promised you at the beginning of this video. Tip number one, pay attention to the problem authors. For each USACO contest, you'll notice that all the problems are attributed to various authors, so USACO actually tells you the author of each problem in the contest. So if you go through all the past USACO contests on the website, you'll notice that the problem authors don't really vary that much from month to month or season to season. Even though problem authors could theoretically write problems involving any concepts they deem appropriate for a particular division, you'll sometimes see patterns in the concepts or difficulty associated with various problem writers. For instance, based on past data, Benjamin Chi, one of the most frequent USACO problem authors as of late, often writes his problems involving math or dynamic programming that tend to be on the higher end of the difficulty spectrum. This doesn't tell us anything about the kinds of problems he'll write in the future, but it can be a good heuristic to guide us. So next time you see a problem by him and don't know where to start, think of how you might be able to approach the problem from a dynamic programming perspective or write a mathematical expression to express what you need to find. Or if you're completely stuck, then it's possible that his problem is also one of the harder problems in the contest, so maybe skip the problem and come back to it later. Tip number two, organize all the information that you have. You'll notice that USACO problems feature a lot of flavor text, and though it's entertaining, during a contest it can get pretty distracting. Your immediate goal when you see a problem should be to figure out exactly what it's asking in simple terms. It can be a great idea to take the contest with a piece of paper you can write on, so you can take all the information you have and break it down to figure out exactly what you know. And if you look at the structure of the information that you have, then with practice, you'll be able to almost instantly classify the problem into the concepts from the map. For example, if time constraint information involves a number 10 to the 5, you'll think of the time complexity O of n log n, which will lead you to think of concepts like sorting, binary search, and tree data structure. Then you can start looking at algorithms and data structures that you know from those concepts and think about how you can apply those to process the information you have. Tip number 3, always read solutions and read them incrementally. Sometimes when you're practicing and you know how to do a problem already, you'll be tempted to just do it and move on. But wait, you should still read the solution. Very often, there are a multitude of possible solutions to USACO problems, and the solution you came up with is only one of many. By reading the solution, you'll often be presented with an approach you didn't think of, and can then learn from. Also, particularly well-written solutions sometimes suggest extensions to problems, which can be great springboards to expose yourself to new concepts. But what if you don't know how to do a problem at all? Should you just sit there and read the entire solution? No, and this brings me to my second point. You should read solutions incrementally. By that, I mean read the solution to a problem bit by bit and stop reading as soon as you have an idea on how to finish the problem on your own. Then, after you finish solving the problem on your own, based on the amount of solution that you've read, go back through the entire solution and make sure you follow all the steps from beginning to end. This step will help you fill in the gaps in your intuition. Then, next time you see a similar problem, you'll have ideas on what to do. And with that, thank you so much for watching. I hope you found this video insightful, and see you in the next one.